I feel like we need to move this up, because this is like our thesis statement.
What counts as fantasy?
Yeah, that can't be the last one. Okay. That should come before our introduction slash banner.
No, the introduction slash banner is the thing that starts the whole fucking thing off.
Oh my goodness.
Our audience continually tells us that they like the introduction and the banter.
They want more banter?
Yes.
They're clamoring for banter?
Fuck it. Let's get this rolling. All right. Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of I Don't Give a Flick. I'm your host, Jonny Blackburn. Alongside me this week are my co-hosts,
Gary Elmore.
Andy O'Reilly.
All right. Everybody, thanks for coming back and tuning in this week. This week, we are going to be discussing fantasy and not only film, but society as a whole. In both gaming and TV and things of that nature. This week, we're happy to bring on our two guests, Chuck Butera, the owner of well, Chuck's Gym. Chuck, welcome to the episode.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
For sure, man. Also welcoming this week for the first time ever, Gary's own flesh and blood, Thomas Elmore. Thomas, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you, Jonathan. It's nice to be here.
So every week we do kind of like to give a little introduction here to our guests. So Chuck, we'll start with you here. You're the first one here that we talked to about this. So kind of just give us a little bit of background on why you are a self-proclaimed fantasy expert.
Well, the first thing I want to say is that I've pretty much consumed fantasy material in one way or the other ever since I was old enough to watch TV. And it's just always stuck with me. No matter what I've done in life or how busy I've been, I've always made time to kind of dig into that hobby at any given moment in different ways. So I don't know about every single thing related to fantasy, but there are a few things that I've really explored extremely deeply, whether it be different pieces of lore or different types of movies or games. So I've dedicated even lots of resources to certain fantasy type hobbies. So yeah, it's probably going to be the way I am until the day I die.
Well said.
Perfect. Well, don't change. We love you.
I'm just a big kid.
I don't want to grow up.
I'm a Toys R Us kid.
No, we'll get struck.
Oh.
Yeah, we're going to get back to that.
No, Toys R Us went out of business.
Yeah, that's true. Man.
We could sing that song all we want. That should be our theme song now.
No.
That's a good idea.
No song will ever be our theme song.
Okay. Well.
Where this hour is coming from. This is your first and last time on here, so I don't.
So I should just say all that I can.
Yeah,
I need as
There's
much.
They're no stopping you now.
But a Fuko.
See, now you're talking, but when I needed the fucking mic check earlier.
Just disregard the drum. Talk about whatever the fuck you want. And Tom, let's get a little background on you. What makes you a self-proclaimed fantasy expert, or why do you love fantasy genre so much?
I don't think I've ever called myself a fantasy expert. That's a strange term.
Where did you come from?
He's an importer, not an exporter of fantasy.
Murders and
are you here?
So, Tom, why are you a fantasy expert? Yeah, Tom, what do you think about what's going on?
Okay, so... Jesus, goodness. I guess I would say that I don't have the hubris to consider myself an expert in anything, let alone... fantasy. It's too
Jesus.
Broad
okay,
ranging.
Thank you.
I'm trying to answer the question.
Okay. All right. Continue.
Let your brother speak.
Where was I?
That you're not hubris.
I'm not hubris. Yes. I'm too humble.
Yes.
A lesser man couldn't be this humble. Is what I've been told.
Oh my God! I'm going to have to edit so much on this fucking podcast.
And it's gone.
So back when would it start when you were kids, like just the fascination with the fantasy realm by itself, or was it kind of like I got into it later in life kind of thing?
Yeah, I would say that we were kids when we enjoyed fantasy.
Was he talking to the two of us? I thought he was talking to the two guests. I'm just putting that out there.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
That's what I understood. I mean,
Damn it.
You married your own dealer, so it's a question for both you guys. But that's okay.
He's inviting you now, but that was definitely intended for the guests.
Have you ever done a podcast before?
Answer the fucking question.
Tom, answer the question.
What was the question? Something about something.
Let's move on to Chuck, the less difficult of our two guests. Chuck, how old were you, what would you say, when you really started to become completely obsessed with the whole fantasy genre?
You know, I was probably 10 years old, maybe even a little younger, the first time I watched The Neverending Story. And it was like off to the, it was off to the races after that. I was just completely wowed by that. So, after that, it seemed like that movie in a way shaped what I would eventually like really enjoy as an adult. So, yeah, I think that's when it started.
Okay. So Chuck, you kind of grew up really liking fantasy and, you know, from when you were a kid, cause you grew up, you know, in the '80s when they had a lot of the really, really good fantasy movies that we kind of, you know, really like, you know, Labyrinth and like, you know, so, I mean, like you had a really cool childhood.
Gary, what year was Labyrinth?
Yeah, I remember.
I believe that was 84.
I think it was 86.
Okay.
I think it was 86. People look at the notes.
Okay.
You might find that it's 86. Sorry, go ahead, Chuck.
That's absolutely what happened to me. I was exposed to that type of thing in pop culture, and you know, my whole generation was as well. And at the time, it was, you know, for children. And you know, here we are now, we're all grown up, and you know, the world has changed, and those things are not just for children anymore. Now, you know, there's an entire subculture of adults and various hobbies and movies, you know, that are made just for us that probably wouldn't be appropriate for kids now.
Right. And,
it's just interesting how things have changed.
Would you say that the movies aren't just for children and they're for adults now? Or would you say that adults are more childlike now? Because I might go with the latter on that.
Well, I mean, yeah, that depends on what you consider a childlike quality. I wouldn't say that enjoying fantasy is inherently a childlike quality, but, you know, when I think of a child, I think somebody that wants results without work right now. And I think that's probably the overwhelming characteristic that defines a child in my mind.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
I went off on a little tangent there.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Doesn't have anything to do with
fantasy. So the entire political party built around wanting one people doing the work. So
okay. Holy shit, that's true.
Lots of edits in this one. Just fucking edit it up, motherfucker. I'm just gonna start getting a beer now. I don't know. Okay, so Chuck, let me ask you this: do you know? I guess many people that
I think they prefer the term short people.
Oh yes, the many ones. Yes.
Oh, God. Do you know many people, M-A-N-Y, that maybe got into fantasy not when they were kids, but when they were older? Or do you think that primarily people that do get into fantasy tend to like it from a young age?
You know, I think I know a lot of both. Because of the nature of my hobbies, I get to meet and shake hands with all kinds of people. Maybe not so much shaking the hands now, but figuratively speaking. And I've definitely met both schools, you know, people that grew up with it and people that didn't. And they both seem to love it and enjoy it equally.
All right. Okay.
Are guests allowed to ask questions of each other?
Absolutely.
Chuck, what do you think makes somebody like something?
That's a good question. I think when somebody likes something, it either gives them something they want or it takes them away from something they don't want. And in my case, you know, I didn't have a particularly pleasant childhood, unfortunately. And so fantasy was kind of my escape. So, you know, those two things are one and the same. I don't know. But I always felt like it took me away from something I didn't want to be experiencing. And just for a couple hours, you know, if nothing else.
That's interesting.
And Yeah, you know, I think that's probably what makes people like something.
Would you say that that's the whole point of fantasy? Like, is that how you would describe the genre of fantasy?
Yeah.
Kind of escapist?
I mean, it's like the humanoid of experiences in a way, you know. It's in a lot of ways, fantasy very closely resembles the lives we have, but there's a few differences, and all of a sudden you have fantasy, you know. And I don't know that we would be able to recognize or even enjoy something that wasn't almost exactly like what we already experience, you know. We would probably think it's strange and not entertaining.
Okay, so that I think is a good point, and I think kind of leads us into our next topic, which is, you know, what are we for this particular podcast going to consider, you know, the fantasy genre? Because, you know, fantasy means different things to different people. So, like, a psychologist would think of fantasy as anything that's not reality. So, you know, what exactly are we talking about for fantasy here?
Mm-hmm. Well, I would probably, there's a few like keywords, I guess, that I would think of immediately. Maybe like magic, dragons, anything medieval in nature.
Okay.
Yeah, stuff like that.
Okay, so sort of the unexplained power from the universe rather than like Star Trek is a fantasy, but it's not the fantasy capital F genre.
That's such a crossover as it is, yeah. You know, it encompasses a couple.
How do you consider Star Wars to fit into this?
The new ones or the old ones?
We're talking about the original trilogy, let's say.
It doesn't.
I would consider the original trilogy to actually be fantasy because it's basically space wizards.
Yeah, that's a good point. My friends and I actually argue about whether or not to call it science fantasy. It's kind of a marriage between sci-fi and fantasy.
I think that's an excellent appellation.
Yeah. It's not a mountain.
Eastern America. No, I mean, I think that a lot of, for me in particular, it would definitely be, yeah, I mean, Chuck, I'd have to agree. I'd say the magic aspect, you know, along with you talk about the mythology and the folklore and whatnot. I think anytime I think of fantasy, you know, I think of, as far as film goes, you think of Lord of the Rings, you know, you think of Harry Potter series, the last ones you guys were talking about earlier, Legend, anything like that.
Yeah,
you know, it really just varies from person to person. Neil, what do you think?
I'm in the same boat. You know, things that follow the lore and what I would consider like high fantasy, you know, magic, wizards, things in that realm.
What do you consider low fantasy?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. That's a good question, Tom.
He said high fantasy. There's got to be that indicates that there must be, it implies there must be a low
very
fantasy.
Low. Yeah.
Yep. And I think we have hit the implication.
Yeah. This topic in general. We'll do a full other episode on what we consider to be low fantasy. How about that? Satisfy everybody. Well,
but I wanted an answer because nobody's going to listen to that, and I wanted to be aware of what your response is.
Okay, since it's your last episode. That's all right. Good point. Yeah, we have to be fair to you.
Neil, you don't have to answer the question. Okay. Gary, so
what do you consider low fantasy?
I didn't use that term, so you can't have me describe it.
You can't engage me in conversation.
All right, I don't know you well enough to get in there.
That's true. That is true.
Okay, so for the purposes of this podcast, we're defining or containing fantasy to mean sort of the magical, mystical fantasy that you'd find in like Lord of the Rings or like the Dark Crystal or something like that, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, good.
So do we count Game of Thrones in this?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, I would say so. Yeah.
I mean, you know, fantasy adventure, you know, that's the thing with fantasy is there's always, and we'll get into it later, but there's always crossover between genres and fantasy in particular. Even with Lord of the Rings, wouldn't you guys consider that not just fantasy, but
fantasy adventure, action, or anything like that.
I would consider Game of Thrones low fantasy.
Okay. Okay. Here, I know you're making a joke, but you brought it up again. Define low fantasy then.
Game of Thrones.
There you go.
I would say low fantasy typically is something that's, you know, set in a more historical setting, but has just a few elements of the unreal to it, you know, if you have a movie of like a medieval village and they have a ghost or something that's haunting them, you know, you could call that low fantasy. Or I know that Peter Jackson, when they were doing Lord of the Rings, wanted Gandalf to have what he termed practical magic. So Gandalf wasn't flinging fireballs around. He was just kind of, he had a little light stone.
No, I hate to interrupt you. But
you'll do it anyway.
Well, before it runs out of my head, there's this movie called The Witch. Have you seen it?
No, I have not seen
it. You haven't seen it? Mm-hmm. It's pretty good. I was going to ask, have any of you seen it?
You people out there listening. You in
Mr. America and all the ships at sea. And, Neil or Johnny or Chuck, have you seen The Witch?
Yeah, I saw it. Yeah.
Would you classify that as low fantasy? Because it's got definitely has like supernatural elements in it, but it is otherwise really realistic, basically.
Yeah. Maybe the amount of things that are unreal can be how you would measure that.
Yeah. I mean, it's the same thing. Yeah, it's the same thing that I brought up earlier. That's a crossover between have you seen some?
Yes. I thought it was good.
Yeah. Okay. So you probably agree that's a fantasy / horror or hell, it could even be a suspense thriller mix, you know. What's cool with fantasy itself is that it really started the whole. It was science fiction before science fiction. It was adventure before adventure. Or you could also make the counter argument that adventure was fantasy before fantasy was fantasy. Ahead of time, you know, we didn't have science fiction and horror, which I think those kind of spread out from fantasy. But nowadays, I don't know. It seems like the fantasy genre itself doesn't, and we'll get into it later, but a whole lot of respect. It doesn't really feel like you have movies that just focus on the fantasy realm. I mean, we've named how many in this episode so far? What, probably six or seven fantasy films or series?
Listening.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Yeah. I'm glad. That's right.
Before you keep going, Johnny, do you consider things like Greek mythology to be fantasy?
You know, that's a really good question.
We're just talking about movies.
I would.
Never mind. Gary, edit that out. I'm getting into a conversation. And I forget we're talking about movies.
Because part of this one is we're going into other elements of it. I think that Greek mythology itself, I'm sure there's maybe, I have no idea, there might still be people across the world that believe in that. But, to me, that would be fantasy. And the stories of, the stories of Hercules and Jason of the Argonauts and whatever, those stories were the origins and the breeding ground for a lot of famous fantasy stories and, you know, novels and movies and TV shows and games that we still hold dear to our hearts today, that we still really love. So yeah, I think to answer your question, yeah, I think that was the start of fantasy, in my mind, at least from my knowledge. I'm sure if you go further back, there's more info and things that actually started the Greek mythology, you know, from 100 years before that or 1,000 years before that or whatever. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. What do you guys think? Actually, Tom, that's a really good question.
I definitely think that's blending in all of these elements that we're trying to discuss and define about the difference between low fantasy and high fantasy. And I just thought it was kind of interesting that actually, I think I brought up the difference between low fantasy, so maybe I shouldn't say that, but I think that's an interesting way to try to, because how many other genres can you be like, oh, this is horror, but, you know, there's high horror and low horror.
Well, I think it's called, you know, it's different things for different genres. So if you have like a sci-fi, If you have something that's set relatively adjacent to the time you're currently in, it might just be considered like a quote unquote low sci-fi, like things are just a little more advanced. Otherwise, mm-hmm. you could be set, you know, hundreds of years in the future and things are much more advanced, which would be a high sci-fi or
a hi-fi. Maybe that's a different kind of between so it's science more, fantasy and science fiction.
Well, it's more a measure of, I guess, the degree to which it alters the story from the real world. So would be the high or the low. So if it's high fantasy, the world is much different in the story than it is in real life. Same way with, you know, high sci-fi.
So where does Star Trek fall in on that?
I would say Star Trek is high sci-fi because they're very they're several centuries in the future.
But it's
wouldn't you say that for their time, that's normal baseline, like fantasy level?
Well, yeah, because they're not. But they're the story, like because we're basing it from where we are. So okay. So if you had a story of someone today. And you told that story in 1920, 100 years ago, and you're like, you know, Jonny whips out his phone and he checks the internet to know when the Dark Crystal was made. That would be like high sci-fi because
1982.
Nice.
So, but we could agree that there is like a difference between, say, the fantasy of a Conan the Barbarian, which I think we can agree is fantasy, and the fantasy of a Lord of the Rings, which is fairly based in like the physics, but then there is also magic.
You know, I don't know. I mean, those two, to because yeah, Conan is definitely there's. I mean, there's not like Balrogs and such running around. Yeah, Lord of the Rings would definitely be high fantasy, and Conan, I would say, would be low fantasy. That'll be the standard that we use. So, how many Conans is it?
How many Conans?
Yes. Yeah.
And what amount of Conans does it translate into high fantasy?
Seven Conans Seven? Equals one Frodo.
Equal one Frodo. Let's nice. Say one Sam. That okay. makes more sense.
Yeah.
I like the scale.
I love it. I love when we come up with new ratings.
Well,
maybe it'll take a current rating system like in Hollywood here.
Perhaps.
Still, you do an episode.
So, Jonny, you want to maybe do your job as host and keep things back on track, or what?
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. I just figured since this is your one and only time doing this, you might like to see how it feels, you know, to
be feels one bad. Of the people. I don't like it. I'm not liking it.
Like, I'm done. I'm fucking
let me ask, just in general, to the panel and our guests.
I appreciate that clarification.
No problem. Do you guys generally prefer like a high, like a Sam yes. or a Conan kind of fantasy level? Because like when I think about things like Magic the Gathering, Chuck, like you said, you're into that. That definitely would be a high fantasy.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. I agree. That's the kind of stuff I like, definitely 100%.
Okay. All right. Neil, what about you?
I'm probably with Chuck. If I'm going to sit down and enjoy a fantasy movie, I'm probably going to enjoy a higher fantasy, Lord of the Rings, than a lower fantasy like a Highlander, which is still an enjoyable movie. It's just not high fantasy.
How many Conans would you
one
give?
One Highlander.
Oh, one.
One Highlander to one Conan.
Oh, he's can only be one. Neil is suggesting that Highlander is the equivalent of Conan.
The equivalent to fantasy
that's
level.
Interesting. Okay.
That's a bold claim to make my
Jonny, what about you? I mean, like, knowing you, I would say that you'd probably like the low fantasy a little bit.
I would anticipate that as well.
Around the Conan Highlander area, I have to say that sure, I like movies like that. I mean, I think that plays into a lot of the stuff that, you know, you and I talk about when we're going those binges of watching movies so bad they're good, and we talk about all, you know, and you, Neil, and I've always talked about this, the entertainment value between the actual story. A movie can still be good and entertaining, and you can still have a fun time watching it. We watch film, we play games, we read stories to escape reality. So, you know, I can appreciate those movies just for the action and the, you know, the
fucking, I don't know, the, some of them, I don't know. I've only seen one Conan film, so I don't know how
Which
many
one was
orgies
it?
They had. The one that you guys made me watch, it was the Arnold Schwarzenegger one.
The one you made me watch.
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
I watched one like 5 years ago, I think.
Yeah, I do remember that. I remember that one.
Yeah. Midway through. But I mean, it was okay, you know. But no, Gary, I mean, I would absolutely have to say I would absolutely prefer a Lord of the Rings or a Harry Potter style series for it. And I guess with Harry Potter, that's not really the folklore mythical aspect, but it is the magic. And I do like stuff like that. What about you?
That's interesting, because like for like when we play like role-playing games, you like a much more realistic kind of game rather than the high fantasy.
I agree. I definitely expected him to be more of a like Pirates of the Caribbean style fantasy,
which is I think a three Conan movie
to me is that's better than a Conan movie for sure. That one for me is definitely that's more action adventure, because
did Johnny just say he thought that the Pirates of the Caribbean movies were better than the Conan movies?
I think he did.
Did he just say that?
Absolutely. I did say that, Tom. You heard it right here, and I don't get it.
Are you editing this out, or what's happening?
I am going to have to edit that out.
Oh my god!
Are you editing?
Oh, he's going to lose all credibility with his audience.
Vanessa will never trust him again.
Us, Vanessa, and my mom, and Susanna, apparently. Our core diehard base.
I feel like you've already lost Susanna with the whole hand rubbing thing.
Oh, for sure. At least he hasn't
been here. Well, yeah. Yeah.
No, I'm not gonna do it.
Gary, what do you prefer? No.
Okay.
I've already asked the question.
I want to answer the question first for you. So, yeah, no, when I play those games, when I'm involved with it, I don't know. You know what? I don't know what it is. I prefer when we play our D&D games, I definitely do prefer ones that are more realistic. But I think with Lord of the Rings, like even outside of the wizards, and I know you have giants and hobbits and trolls and whatnot, but for the most part, you feel free to disagree, but it is a little bit more realistic than something like the Labyrinth or maybe even Harry Potter, because you know they're fighting for the most part with swords and arrows and on horseback, and I love that medieval warfare time period. And even though they've added elements of mythological races in, and there's a little bit of magic here and there, it doesn't feel like the entire storyline is driven by the mythical aspect. It's a driving force, but it's not the only one.
Maybe that's the real difference between high fantasy and low fantasy, is that in a high fantasy, like the supernatural and magical elements are really what are driving the plot.
But the whole plot's driven by a magical ring that controls all the other magical rings.
Oh, you mean in Lord of the Rings?
Yeah.
I'm not the one who said it. Oh, Johnny has to defend this.
We have record of me saying that, so, you know, you need to play that, Harry. Go ahead.
Okay. Fair enough.
So, Gary, then, that same question back to you, then.
For me, personally, I think I do like the high fantasy a little bit more. I think that to me lends a more creative aspect. Like if you're watching it on film or you're reading a book, especially, you get a lot more of, you know, yourself that you are allowed to enjoy your, oh God, I've backed myself into a corner. You're allowed to enjoy your creative juices a lot more.
Oh, that's where that was going. Yeah. Okay.
Something
else. Okay.
You're allowed to enjoy your creative mind more.
Yes. That's not great, but it's much better than it could have been.
You know, it's nice to sit down, read a book, and create a world in your own head about it. And I think that it challenges you more to do it when you're talking about a higher fantasy kind of realm.
Okay. So that's a good kind of segue into the next topic anyways. So we kind of briefly touched on what we thought maybe fantasy origins might start with. Tom and brought up the Greek mythology thing. So that's good. So today, or in the last, I can say even the last couple hundred years, I think we can all agree that fantasy has definitely, you know, dug its hand into, you know, the film, TV, literature, gaming.
Did he say dug its hand in? What is that a common phrase I've just never heard?
Well, Tom, you've been living under a rock for the last 30 some odd years of your life.
I've really dug my hands in under that rock.
Yeah.
I'm not familiar with that name. What is that?
I'm sorry. Yes, I just came up with it.
It's over the last 100 years or so, it's definitely been a... Because I think fantasy is probably like one of the oldest, if not the oldest, genre of stories, because you definitely didn't have sci-fi, 4,000 years ago.
You know, Jonny suggested something like this earlier, and I don't know that I agree. I feel like probably horror...
Horror definitely would be one.
...might predate it.
But does not horror... Especially in the older stories.
I argue that horror stems from fantasy. The argument that I think you could make, what I talked about earlier, was action-adventure predating fantasy. So, agreed. Why do you think horror would predate fantasy, Tom?
Because I feel like one of the first things people would have done would be spin stories about the things that are out in the darkness.
Yeah, around a campfire.
Outside of the cave.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So don't you think that a lot of those stories, though, that were told around a campfire, in the cave, whatever, back in the day, a lot of those stories started with a hero, and a hero going on a journey and on a trek to accomplish some monumental goal, and that's how things came to be.
Well, I think that the stories that began would have been more proto-humans or burgeoning Homo sapien discussing things that they're aware of in their real life that they are then sensing, or that they know for a fact, walk around in the darkness just beyond the flickering lights of their campfires. And they would be suggesting that if you leave this area that we know of, bad things could happen. And bad things can also happen to you inside of this area, because they're like scorpions, spiders, saber-toothed tiger come snatch you away.
Okay, yeah, just really any dangerous animal. It was a terrible time to live.
It was very dangerous.
But I mean, like, it's interesting because you see, like, even nowadays, like, recently they had that Slender Man, which was
Grandpa.
He's right.
That's true. Okay. Compared to the Appalachians.
Yes.
The Appalachians live around a couple years. So.
But yeah, like, you know, we still do that. You know, we're still, you know, humans. We're afraid of the dark and what goes bump in the night. So we haven't lost that element of our humanity. But thankfully, Thomas Edison invented the light bulb to banish the darkness.
To push it back just a few hours until we could survive.
Exactly.
Until the rosy-fingered dawn can kiss the face of God
himself, yes.
Oh, all right. That's just the brothers on one, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Brothers on one. So fantastic. With fantasy,
oh, but leave the hands thing in. That was gold.
That was entertaining. You get some inspiration points. Since it's been so prevalent in the last 100 years, what's everybody's favorite, I guess, category that fantasy's in right now, between what we talked about, film, TV, literature, games? What do you enjoy the most? You know, for me, you guys could probably all guess it's film. It always has been.
What you're saying is what medium do we prefer to enjoy fantasy?
You enjoy fantasy the most from? Chuck, how about you?
I'm definitely into the games. Mm-hmm. Video games, card games, in some cases even board games. The more complicated and hard they are to learn, the more fun I'm having. So... everything from Risk to Magic the Gathering, like strategy, all that, Warhammer.
I have a
Final Fantasy games.
I have a board game you'd like. It's called Prophecy.
Yeah.
I'll probably super work complicated.
Like that. It's not super complicated.
It really is. He's a simple thing.
So let me ask you this, Chuck. You like sort of the game aspect of it, and I assume that like card game, like Magic, would be your favorite of that subgenre, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's definitely if I had to pick one game, it would be Magic the Gathering. It's probably my favorite game. Yeah.
Is it because of the lore of Magic, or is it because of the mechanics of the card game itself?
It's both. I love both of those things very much. Okay. The story is rich and full of, you know, full of history, and it's a very long story. Mm-hmm. And you don't even need to know any of that, though, to play and love the game, you know? Like, it's the guy that created Magic the Gathering, his name is Richard Garfield. And just fun fact real quick, yeah. Richard Garfield's great-great-grandfather was President Garfield.
Really? That is interesting.
Yep, Richard Garfield has a PhD in mathematics.
Mathematics? And, oh, my God.
Yeah. He's technically a doctor and a mathematician.
You know what else?
So
the only president to ever serve two non-consecutive terms, President Garfield.
Really?
No, I think it was Grover Cleveland, but they're very similar.
Yeah.
And, I don't know any Garfield facts, but there you go. I know he hates Mondays.
Guess where Richard Garfield got the idea for Magic the Gathering?
Ohio.
From D&D.
I can easily see that.
It's the whole reason why he created the card game is because he loved D&D so much.
And D&D, of course, had its origins in Lord of the Rings.
Well, tangentially.
Is that where, to just kind of piggyback off that, Gary, is the gentleman who created D&D, what was his name again, I'm sorry?
Gary Gygax.
And so did he say that? He's like, oh, I got this inspiration from Lord of the Rings?
I don't know if he ever so much straight out and said that, but you can definitely see that.
Just read through the March manual, he didn't just take that from Lord of the Rings.
The what?
Say again?
I said, just read through the monster manual and tell him, just rip it from Lord of the Rings.
Yeah. I'm sure he did. I'm sure Tolkien inspired him, you know, completely, maybe a little, but, oh man, that's interesting. It's just, you know, everything inspires the one craze inspires the next craze and so forth.
It's said that a good artist borrows from what he knows and a great artist steals.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Leave that in. Do not edit that out.
Was it the president?
Edit that one out. That gets edited. That's on the cutting room floor.
So, Neil, what kind of fantasy do you like? What kind of fantasies do you like, Neil?
This is not a productive area of discussion. Yes.
Oh, wow. What kind of podcast is this?
As far as medians, if we're talking about medians, how I enjoy getting my fantasy fix. Film is good. I enjoy the games, but I also enjoy reading the fantasy because film is nice, but it's someone else's vision of what's going on. Mm-hmm. Although you're reading someone's story, you know, in your mind, you're creating your own vision of what's going on. I think that's what intrigues me the most.
Now, Neil, you read almost all of those Star Wars books.
That are unfortunately not canon anymore.
Do you consider that fantasy?
I would consider it fantasy.
Okay. Like, do you think it's high fantasy?
No. Because to me, it's still set in what I would consider like a normal world that has magical elements, but it's not its own world with its own physical rules.
It could operate even without the Force. That's kind of what you're saying. Okay. Do you think of the Force as magic or as its own thing?
Mm-hmm. I would say the Force to me is its own thing.
I agree. I'm agreeing in agreements with that.
Oh my God.
So do you think that this is, you guys probably already talked about this, but do you think that the elements of what happened in Rise of Skywalker in regards to the Force specifically are completely okay?
What do you mean?
We're veering a
this
little.
This is we've agreed that the Star Wars is fantasy. So this is. I want to know if he thinks the Rey reaching over and healing people is an okay thing for the Force to do.
Neil, you don't have to answer that.
What is the genre though? It's a question about the story.
It is a question about the story. that's involved in the genre, and I'm just going to say that I think everything in those last three movies is crap.
Okay, there you go. Thank you.
You didn't like Babu Freak.
A whole other podcast to appease everybody.
Chuck, what did you say about Star Wars? Star Wars.
No, not Star Wars.
We've agreed
Star
it's
Wars.
Fantasy. It is on record as being fantasy.
Four Conans.
Four Conans equals one Ray. Yeah. Got it.
Okay.
Nice, so fine. Nice.
You guys are saying that this one would be more, Neil, you said you classified it more as a low fantasy than a high. Star Wars in general.
You know, Johnny, can you please take away, stop talking about Star Wars life. And get focused?
Take away lightsabers and the Force, and it's still a functional world in low fantasy. Like, it's still a space fantasy.
So
it's.
Keep going, sir.
The end of the season.
So just to clarify then, are we, this is to everybody actually, are we classifying low fantasy then as a story that takes place in a world similar to our own? Because I would disagree that Star Wars is not even close to a world.
I think that it's been agreed that low fantasy means a world which is in and of itself self-sufficient, whereas a high fantasy is a world that doesn't make sense and probably couldn't work without the fantasy elements like magic and monsters and stuff. Supernatural.
Sure. Okay. Under the constructs of...
And as Neil has mentioned, Rogue One operates without any of the classical elements we think of for Star Wars, so I think he's correct that it cuts the mustard as a low fantasy setting.
But the best part of that movie was the end with Darth Vader.
Oh, putting it into
very, very, very good. But you clarified the definition for me, so I do agree that that does make more sense. I think it was a little confused on what we were describing.
Johnny, that's why you brought me into this podcast, is to clarify things for you.
There you go.
You're welcome.
That's right, man. Yeah. Fantasy is your that's your jam.
Another point for Tom.
Another point, another inspiration.
God, I'm racking them up.
Tom, same question. What's your favorite medium for fantasy?
I think that's a strange question to ask, because I think at various times in my life, I'm going to enjoy, when I read a book, I enjoy it, and I'm not sitting there thinking, I'd rather be playing a video game.
You're weird.
If someone came up to you and said, you can either play D&D with our own group.
Anything else. What's the other options? I'll take that right away.
That's the right choice.
You can play this new video game, and you had those three options. What would you choose?
What were they again?
Read a book.
playing D&D with a group, reading your favorite fantasy novel, or binge watching series of your favorite fantasy movies.
I have difficulty when you're asking me like to enumerate my favorite X, when your favorite song, favorite movie. It's so in the moment that I'm like, this is the best thing I've ever seen. My favorite band is Rush, or at some points it's going to be Tenacious D, or the Eagles.
Oh, the Eagles.
Or my favorite book could be whatever, things people read. I don't know, but.
Book.
But it's a very difficult and strange question to me to try to narrow it down to if I like video games more than TV shows. Because there are some TV shows that are good. There are movies that are good. You have to, I feel like it's the kind of thing you got to compare them one thing to the other. You can't compare the genre.
The medium?
Okay. Well, I was about to say the medium.
Yeah, that too. You know what, both.
It's personal preference. It's personal preference. And if that's how you feel, then that's how you feel. Gary, what about you? Are you on the same side as Tom here, or do you have one that you typically prefer over the others?
I like books.
No, he doesn't. I have never seen him read a book.
I have read
his
a book.
Life.
I like books because they force me to.
There is a $60 Tales of the Iron
Knights. I'm trying to tell a story.
It's Gary's turn, not
Tom's turn to lie. I like books because they force me to get into a different mental state than like watching a movie or playing a video game does, because you have to focus and, you know, read and take time and kind of slow down and think about what you're doing a little bit more. So I like the way reading books makes me feel.
So what you're saying is you're smarter than Jonny because he can't focus or slow down.
No.
And he likes movies and you like books.
What he's saying is he's smarter than you, Tom, because he can make an opinion.
He says that all the time. That's not going to be news to anybody.
Thank you, Neil. Thank you. I think you're going to do well in the next game.
Oh, can I edit all that out? My real answer is my favorite genre is the game that Gary is running.
There you go.
Yeah.
No, don't.
Mark this area, this section right here.
Spider-Man 2 is a subpar film, so let's just be honest.
Oh, my God.
Speaking of which, that's a great segue into whether superheroes are the fantasy genre or not.
Goody. All right. We'll jump into the Tom. Sorry, Gary, did you want to finish?
No, I'm done.
Okay. All right.
It was great being here. Thank you for having me. I'm glad I could help Jonny stay focused and define things for him.
I gotta say, you're more all over the place than I am.
I'm gonna be so mad if this is our most popular episode. I'm gonna be so mad.
It will be. It's got Chuck on.
Is he? Exactly.
Everybody loves Chuck. Okay, we can hop around a little bit. It seems like you're wanting to talk about this, Tom, and it is an interesting topic. So let's jump through what counts as fantasy film genre. Do hero movies count? Do we think they count? Tom, you start because it was your question you posed.
And you have to answer the question. You can't be like, oh, it depends on how I'm feeling right here.
It's bullshit what we don't. Just give us a full straight answer, okay?
I've had to put up with this for 32 years.
You
I just
don't
want
read.
You to know.
Stop telling people you read books.
I read books. Okay.
Obviously, superhero movies are fantasy. But it also depends on what superhero you're talking about. Not even just like Marvel versus DC, but some superheroes fall into low
Iron
fantasy
Man.
And some fall into high fantasy, because you got Superman and without the fantasy elements, he doesn't work at all. But you've got Batman, and that's low fantasy because he's kind of above and beyond what a human can do, but not so much that you can't believe it. Like, there's nothing you can't remove from that where he falls apart. He still works.
Well, I mean, like, it also starts to tread on the sci-fi area a lot, because, like, people have over the last 8 decades tried to explain Superman in a scientific way, or Peter Parker, to take a less controversial one.
Right, but the reason that's, like, you're not entirely wrong, because there's always bleed over in genres, but the way people explain away Superman's powers, it's like pseudoscience, so it's definitely fantasy. It's the same science as in Star Trek, where a lot of the stuff is just technobabble to try to cover these gaps that we don't have any idea how a warp core works. So they're just like, this. We got to replace the harmonic adapters. And in Superman, it's like, oh, he creates like this energy field around himself that does stuff.
Binds us and penetrates us.
That's not canon anymore, unfortunately.
Oh. What?
No, because you were talking about Star Wars. And edit that out. Edit this out, Gary.
This whole episode is edited.
Just cut it.
Okay.
38 usable audio. So.
It's just me and Chuck the entire time.
Good to have you on, Chuck.
So this, Tom, you saying this about, and I'm not necessarily in disagreement with you, but just for the sake of argument, play devil's advocate. Our definition of fantasy earlier was based off magic, based off folklore, based off mythology. For the most part. So would superhero films, would that be a subset genre of fantasy? Like, could we agree on that? Could we find a middle ground on that? Or do you just think it's full out fantasy? And that's it.
What makes you proposed that it would be a subset genre.
That it would be a subset genre? Because, like we talked about, as in pretty much any film today, there is that crossover, you know, the bleed over, as you had called it, between multiple genres. I would say that there are definitely fantasy elements inside of the Marvel, or God forbid, the DC movies, you know, I would just say that there, personally, I feel that there's more of an element of the action adventure than opposed to just fantasy. I feel like the story is driven by the prototypical action adventure formula as opposed to the fantasy formula, which I don't even know if there is a formula in Hollywood anymore for the fantasy genre. Feels like the fantasy aspect is just, I don't know, to me it feels kind of secondary. You know, I don't know if that makes sense.
Like it's more of just a setting, kind of like how we talked about the sci-fi one.
Before you answer that, I understand, like, what you're saying does make sense to me, but it feels like action adventure is a strange thing to pin an entire genre on, because in some sense, everything has action and adventure. There's always a protagonist going through some sort of plot that usually has action.
You've obviously never seen The English Patient.
No, I haven't.
Typically in an action adventure, though, the events that are life-threatening. And in a lot of those movies and a lot of action adventure films, it's those same events. So yeah, you could say there's action in a sci-fi, there's action in a suspense thriller.
Yes, you could.
Jonny cutting out. They're going to die. They're going to cease to exist. I don't know.
I think that my response to this would be, I believe that the plot of pretty much all superhero stories would be action adventure. However, I think that the setting would fall into fantasy, because they've got elements that don't exist in the real world, which I think we've agreed is fantasy. That's where we're
at. Sci-fi, though.
Sci-fi is, in my opinion, it's more speculative. Like, there's an actual genre called speculative science fiction. Well, of course, you know this because it's in the books. So, I mean, you're so into literature.
What books?
But in general, it's, science fiction is more about, this is like, here's a thing. Like, here's the real world, and we're changing this or adding this. And that's science fiction, where we are thinking about, like, the human condition, but with a little twist. Whereas fantasy is more like, this whole world exists, and this element or this person or this thing is basically supernatural in some way. It's like above the rest of the characters in this story. So I think you can have the fantasy. That's why we're having so much trouble with this Star Wars versus Star Trek kind of thing, where is it science fiction, is it science fantasy? And it's because they're telling stories, and then the setting is just a little bit different. So that's what's muddying the waters, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Okay. So same question posed to you, Chuck. What do you feel? What do you feel about, you know, superhero films? Do you feel that they are primarily more fantasy as opposed to action adventure, or do you think there's another genre we're leaving out? Maybe.
Let's just bring them all in. Talk about everything that's ever happened.
Yeah, I'd probably say more action adventure. They do have aspects of fantasy.
Okay, well, it's been good having you on, Chuck. We'll talk to you next time.
I know, right? Yeah, it's been fun. All right,
I'll take it easy.
I think certain superheroes lean more toward, you know, fantasy. Like, for example, Thor, you know, obviously comes from Asgard, wields, you know, the power of lightning and thunder and this giant hammer. You know, that's a very...
folklore, yeah.
Yeah, that's a very fantasy-tied superhero. That's what I would think anyway. But, you know, not all of them are like that, in my opinion. You know, a lot of them more lean just straight toward action-adventure, like Batman, Spider-Man, you know, Iron Man, things that could feasibly happen within reason, you know.
Because
so,
do you think that's enhanced because of the scientific aspect? Is the question?
Yeah.
Chuck.
Yeah, I mean, like, if you have enough money, you know, and you have the mind to do something like that,
okay.
And I don't see why that's not possible, especially nowadays.
So, Tom, that goes, so I guess the question, so back to you, do you agree with Chuck there, just because of the scientific aspect?
Do I think that it's more action and adventure because it's plausible? If you have enough money, is that what you're saying?
Yes.
That's a good question. Let me think on that for a minute.
Okay. Same. So, Neil, what about you?
Neil?
He's thinking.
Did we lose Neil? Oh, okay.
He's a deep thinker. That's the one thing I know about Neil.
Yep.
I'm just imagining him with his chin on his fist pondering.
It's a tough question. Let me rephrase it, I guess. Do you guys think it's more of a fantasy aspect if the superhero is if their superpowers come from some form of magic or mythical, you know, powers, I guess, from mythical source, and is it more action adventure if they get all of their powers primarily from the scientific aspect? So, would Fantastic Four or even Spider-Man or Iron Man, for that matter, would those heroes naturally fall into the action adventure genre easier because you don't have the magic or the mythical aspect to it?
So, what you're asking is,
I would say, yes.
Is Thor more fantasy than Superman because he's a god, correct, and Superman's an alien?
Superman's a little hard. And Superman, I'm saying is Thor more fantasy than than Iron Man? Thor, Hawkeye, exactly. And they receive all of their powers from the money or the natural skills they possess, whereas Thor or Superman, they receive their powers from this otherworldly presence, you know, whether they be an alien or be a demigod or whatever.
What do you think, Gary?
I don't know. We've done a couple of episodes where we talk about, you know, sci-fi and fantasy. And I think that the more I talk about these distinctions, the more arbitrary they get to be in my mind, because it doesn't, you know, like we've kind of spoken about it several times, like whether it's sci-fi, you know, whether it's one Conan or one Sam, or, you know, it's, you know, it's just the setting that it takes place in. The real meat of the story is, you know, what happens inside the story, you know, in terms of, like, is it a comedy or drama, you know, how do the characters interact with one another? So the more I talk about these different sort of fantasy sci-fi genres, the more I kind of feel like they're very, very much just sort of window dressing, because you could take the exact same story as Star Wars and put it into a Lord of the Rings setting without any difficulties, and, you know, vice versa. That's just kind of the apostrophe that came to me.
Sure. So why doesn't, it's a question to everybody, why doesn't fantasy necessarily get the respect many, you know, at least from this group, I would say, that many think it deserves? You know, why are there, because we all know that, you know, crossover between genres in film, it just happens. You know, even in games and literature, whatever. But we define fantasy today as having some type of world developed with a heavy influence on the magical, folklore, mystical aspect in some way, shape, or form. Why are we not seeing as many types of series or movies like that? We get them every once in a while. You have Lord of the Rings, and you've got Game of Thrones, and we mentioned Harry Potter earlier. You know, and you have, there's one-hit wonders, you know, Pan's Labyrinth, The Labyrinth, whatever. Why do we think that it's not as popular in film today? Well, why can people just not get behind it? We see what horror, everybody's making a horror movie nowadays. Everybody makes a rom-com. Everybody makes action adventure. Why don't we see more fantasy movies? Why does it not get the respect that it probably deserves? Because it seems like a lot of genres nowadays stem from the fantasy genre itself. So thoughts on that to anybody? This is open to the whole panel.
I think that Chuck touched on this earlier when he was talking, and he was like, he grew up on, you know, the fantasy movies, but I believe he did mention that, and I agree with, they are seeing a resurgence in popularity, and perhaps acceptance would be the better word. As I mean, you got more people playing D&D than ever. I mean, it's a big deal.
Nerds,
yeah, on YouTube and everything.
Yeah.
And, there's Day Nine, who plays Magic the Gathering against fairly famous celebrities. It's just a, and not to mention Lord of the Rings. And I think the issue is, like Gary just alluded to, that we're trying to...
The negative connotation to being into this genre.
Right, yeah, because as Chuck said at the start, you know, it's associated with, you know, childlike wonder. And what? How did you say that you thought about children, Chuck? It was beautiful. It's like, I hate them because they only want stuff.
That's not what he said. He said that his definition of them was somebody who wanted, like, instant gratification. He didn't, it was like, and I hate them for it.
I was close. Sure, you're
all right. That's definitely a childlike quality, though, is wanting, you know, you want things right now, and you don't understand the idea of investing and working on something long term. Mm-hmm. So, To add to the conversation, I think one of the reasons why we may be seeing more of a resurgence now is because people were really afraid of stuff like this in the 90s. There was something called the Satanic Panic.
Yeah.
And Magic the Gathering got doxxed in the mainstream for having certain types of art on the cards. And people were afraid of fantasy, you know. People were afraid of demonic possession. People were afraid of, you know, Satan. And a lot of that stuff is laughable now in the mainstream. But at the time, it was a serious thing, you know. Like, I know a lot of people who got their cards thrown away or burned, by their parents because they saw an article on the news, you know. Is Magic the Gathering turning your child into a Satan worshiper?
They think they're summoning demons and everything.
Yeah, it was a very real fear.
That's interesting. I never heard of that, Chuck. So do you by chance, do you know any...
You've never heard of that? That's super famous. Yeah,
Actually a very, it's called the Satanic Panic. You can actually just Google it and read up on it. And a lot of people say it's not completely dead, which obviously I'm sure it's not going to be completely dead. But as far as, you know, its widespread reach it used to have, I don't think it has that anymore. But yeah, people were really afraid of that, you know, like, yeah, it was a very real thing. The people that created Magic the Gathering actually had to go back and change the art on some of their cards and apologize, you know? And yeah, absolutely. They were like in trouble with the media, like right away. So, it was a real thing. And there were even movies made about it. The movies didn't do very well. But there's a movie about...
called Mazes and Monsters with Tom Hanks.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. I was like, I know you're about to say the same thing I'm thinking. Yeah, it's a movie with Tom Hanks, and it's about a guy that basically gets kidnapped by evil spirits because he plays D&D. And it made it into the movies.
I believe that was his second major role. I think it was 84, 85?
It was a terrible movie. I don't know.
It was very old. Yeah, it was bad. Yeah.
And they started LARPing it, and then he started, like, kind of going crazy.
He's trying to kill him. Yeah,
it's been a couple of years since I've seen that movie.
Magic
the Gathering, that was, like, early 90s, wasn't it?
Yeah, 1993.
Yeah, it came out at the worst possible time.
Yep. People were very afraid of that.
That's so interesting because, you know, so this is a question to you, Gary and Tom. I mean, D&D has been out since when?
I believe 77 or 79 is in.
Okay. Well, the original with like Gary Gygax and them all made up their original stuff off of about 74. Mm-hmm. And then I think they were maybe a little bit earlier, and then they got published around 74. And then they started making their actual own, because it was built off of the back of a totally different
war gaming system. War simulator kind of game.
And then they actually came up with D&D rules for it later on, I think about 76. Mm-hmm. So
I actually have the first ever D&D book in front of me right now. Oh, let me see if I can find a date.
Is that the one with the red cover?
Yeah, no.
No, it's going to be pale one with the beholder on it, I think.
This book is very beat up. Let me see if I can find a date somewhere on it.
So while Chuck's looking for that, to the D&D side, why did D&D also have this type of
Dungeons & Dragons is like what started it all. Yeah. All the parents were like, our kids are hanging out in basements around this weird table full of stuff, and they're all in robes and calling each other
these strange looking dice.
Yeah, calling each other more than six sides. That's what I was saying. Magic the Gathering. I didn't know it was based off that. I can easily believe it because I don't know a lot about it, but I do know that a lot of the lore is like they've got elves and everything. Yeah. So it came out at just the wrong time to pick up on the tail end of all of like the height of that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I think as a society today, though, we're past this.
No.
Right?
We
moved past this.
Absolutely not.
It was a society on the whole. You don't hear much about it, but there are still people who definitely think, you know.
Sure, but I'm not talking about pockets of people. I'm not talking about
if you're not talking about pockets of people, then we have moved past the society.
Right. That's what. Yeah. I mean, I'm not talking about the evangelist family that lives in the Bible Belt.
Editing that out too.
Society today, it doesn't seem like that's really a problem at all. So I want to go back to something Neil had mentioned earlier. Neil had you had said something about that the fantasy genre had a negative connotation attached to it. What did you mean by that exactly? Can you elaborate really quick?
Yeah, I mean, me, Gary, our group of friends in high school were into fantasy. And
nerds.
Outside of that group, people didn't know really that we were into fantasy. Why? Because there was a negative connotation. There was people who think that it's nerdy, it's childish, you know, people that kind of, I guess, look down on it. You know, even now, I'm 33 years old. My wife understands that I play D&D, but she doesn't get it. She's tried, and she just doesn't understand.
She did a great job.
So,
what did you laugh for?
Good job. Edit that out. Good job. I played like 5 years ago. but, I mean, you know, people at work, I don't talk about, you know, my fantasy, you know, time with my coworkers because there's that negative connotation that I just assume they're not going to understand. Which could be wrong on my part, that they could also be, I guess, what, closet fantasy fans?
They're putting this in some really weird light.
I have to admit, out of that closet now.
Yeah, I have to admit, I agree with Neil, because when I came over to do that thing you guys were all doing at that guy's house with your doing the Eye of the Beholder thing, and I was an extra in that.
Mm-hmm.
At one point, Vanessa was there, and we were all standing around trying to just make conversation, and she's like, Thomas is my dungeon master, and he runs this thing for us. And all these people were looking at me. She's like, "Tell him about it." And I'm like, "No, I don't want to bring that up at all."
Tom, I think you have a natural trepidation around people, anyway.
Yes, yeah. But I'm trying to agree with Neil.
Okay,
but yeah, he's fine on radio. Yeah, he's fine on radio.
I can't shut him up. But Neil, yeah, I mean, like, I see what you're saying. I mean, like, we had our reputations to maintain. I mean, we were the theater guys.
Oh, Jesus.
Nice.
We wanted the ladies to love us.
We didn't want people to think we were nerds. Good Lord.
Yeah, I know.
Good Lord, we were putting our makeup on in the hallway getting ready for a show.
And then also our theater makeup.
Oh, yes. Chuck, did you find the publication date on that?
I did. I actually sent a picture of it to the group chat. It was this particular book in front of me was produced in 1978.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. There may actually be one that was printed before that I'm not aware of, but this is the oldest book known to me that was published for D&D.
Yeah,
this looks like I have a sister book right here, a softback, and I couldn't find a date on it, but it looks like it goes along with its supplemental material for making maps and things. But yeah, I found this stuff at a thrift store a long time ago, and I was like, oh man, I have to buy that.
Yeah. Have you read through it at all?
Yeah, I did read a little bit of it. I haven't read front to back on it, but me and my friends actually started playing D&D recently, and I had never played. And so I loved it. I had a blast playing.
Which one did you
play? I jumped right in. I played 5e.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah, and I played. I hosted two groups a week.
Oh my
took
God.
Them through identical. Yeah, I mean, I jumped right
you
in.
Sure did.
I mean, yeah, I jumped right in, and it was a lot of work. Yeah. I was not prepared for how much work it was. But I look back on that time fondly. But I was glad when it was over.
So Chuck, let me ask you. let me ask you, Chuck. What did you enjoy about running a game?
Man, seeing how much fun they were having really made me feel good. Mm-hmm. And it made it all worth it, you know. All the writing the story and drawing the maps and painting the terrain and painting the minis.
Oh, you really did go all in.
Practicing accents so that I could act out different characters.
I want to play in your campaign.
I think, you know, kind of just so we can have some semblance of a topic today, I think that kind of touches back on, you know, the fantasy stories. You know, people like to create them, to be creative. And Chuck, I know you're a very creative guy. I mean, I've seen you. You know, a lot of the parties I've hosted, like, you really get into characters when we do murder mysteries, those kind of things, which is great.
Yeah.
And people like to be creative, and especially when your creativity can harness the power of other people's creativity and you all work together to tell a story.
Synergy.
Yeah. People will go to great lengths to be entertained.
That's for sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
which is why they say they'll do just about.
Nobody's listening to this. Yeah.
People will do just about anything to be entertained. It's, you know.
So to dip back to the original question that I posed, with this negative connotation that you guys are referring to, and then, you know, Chuck coming in and saying he loves fantasy and loves the story behind it for these reasons. If there is such a market for it, why are we not? Chuck, you'd also said that we're seeing a bit of a reprise from them over the last, I don't know how we've been the last couple of years. Outside of Game of Thrones, I would unfortunately have to disagree with you a little bit that I don't really see much of, I guess, maybe I'm wrong, correct me if I'm wrong. I mean, if there are shows or movies that I haven't seen, please suggest them. I'd love to check them out. But for the film's sake, I don't really feel like that we've really seen anything recently. I feel like fantasy is it's taken such a back seat compared to the other major genres, and it's sad. It really is. Do you guys think that's just because is it not marketable anymore? Like, or is it because it comes with that negative connotation? If you like Lord of the Rings or if you like Harry Potter, are you a fucking nerd? You know,
I mean, like the movie Frozen made several billion dollars.
Oh my God!
Look,
that's not talking about. I'm not talking about animated Disney. Well, I'm talking about Lord of the Rings made a killing in those three films. I know The Hobbit fucking sucked and it did horrible.
I have an answer. Okay. I think it's the correct answer. I think that the answer is Jonny is defining fantasy as purely high fantasy in the Lord of the Rings. If it's not dragons and wizards.
He's forgetting the whole Conan.
The saturation of Conan. Yeah. No, but...
Where Conan hasn't been coming out either.
But I don't think that's entirely wrong. I'm just... people are... Like, I was saying... Superheroes, in my opinion, are fantasy, and you guys are like, well, that's more science fiction. So I think we're seeing that we're kind of talking past each other about what we... I think Gary alluded to this earlier when he was like, it's all kind of window dressing. But also, the real answer to your question is because nobody has written a Lord of the Rings in a long time, and Hollywood doesn't have any of its own ideas. That's why it made The Hobbit into three movies instead of just one good one.
That's a money grab for sure.
And
absolutely.
See any more. And that's the most recent fantasy movie made from a book series is like Artemis Fowl, or that one from the guy. It's not even from the book series. It's like from a little note that J.K. Rowling wrote herself, where it's like mysterious beasts and where to find them or something. Mm. It's just that people don't have any ideas for that, other than even Frozen. Is actually based on kind of a you know, a myth from I don't know where this came from, but it's, you know, the Ice Princess.
Probably Scandinavian.
Hans Christian Andersen or the Brothers Grimm or something like that. So that's the real reason, is people just don't have any new fantasy ideas if you're talking about high fantasy.
Or maybe it's just fantasy has evolved to be more superheroes, because, like, there's tons of those kind of movies that have come out.
I agree. I'm in agreement with that. Okay. Although I also think that Batman's fantasy, so.
Do you think people just kind of got burnt out of the fantasy? Because that between 90 and 2000, people got hit hard between Lord of the Rings, you know, all the Harry Potters, any of the zombie movies, any vampire movie, werewolves. I feel like people just got so bombarded with them, they may have just got burnt out of them.
Wow, so you're saying, zombie movies are fantasy.
Well, Neil, I mean, like, people, have they gotten burnt out of superhero movies? You know, I don't know that just because you've had a lot of the same type of movie, people get burnt out on them. I think as long as the quality of the movie is still there, people will like them.
I agree, but I know every time we've gone to see a Marvel movie, every time, everybody in the group, except for maybe Jonny and me, are like, okay, that's the last one for me. I'm kind of done. But then we go back, and I'm not poking fun of you guys for having a thought. I'm just like, what is it? Like, would we feel oversaturated?
Well, Marvel does a great job of keeping you on the hook, because you're like, well, I've already invested 10 years to finish this segment of the movie.
It's like a marriage. You just keep going.
I was
going
to say, Suzanne probably feels that same way. Edit that out, Gary. You cut that out.
No, you keep that. I'm curious. You keep that.
I stopped recording a long time ago. Yeah.
We're just talking. What are you talking about, editing?
We're just catching up. That's a good point, man.
Thank you.
And Gary, maybe you're right. Maybe you're right, Gary. Maybe it's just gotten to the point, and that's what Neil's point is. And Neil, that's a good point. You know, we've talked about this, three of us, on prior episodes, that every decade typically has a few fads or trends. You know, the zombie movie, as you pointed out, in the 2000s, and then superheroes now. I don't know. You brought up Game of Thrones, Neil, and it had such widespread popularity for the last 7 years, you know, or last 7-8 years, for the last decade then. And
it had a lot of
I felt like it did have a lot of nudity.
And violence.
I felt that was still that was the last stand of the true full true to itself fantasy genre. I guess would be the best way to put it. You know, I haven't released this because I'm still a believer that that the superhero movies are, there's fantasy elements in it, and it is fantasy, but it's more action adventure. I don't know. I kind of miss the Game of Thrones, Lord of the Rings stuff. Like, I feel like we need a little bit more. I feel like I'd like to see some more. You know,
Jonny.
And it was just that one series, it seemed.
Do you feel that? I know this is not recent, but do you feel that the Matrix movies were fantasy?
Good question, and I think that's one of the crossovers between an action adventure, a sci-fi, and a fantasy as well. I definitely would say that it has a lot of fantasy elements, Tom. But honestly, I think it's more of an action adventure or even sci-fi to me. Well,
they definitely started off more sci-fi, but by the third one, it had definitely moved into a more spiritual realm.
Yeah, I guess that's true. You know, when I think of fantasy, just, and it's really just for the sake of the episode in particular, I will say when I think of fantasy, I do think of those movies that we mentioned, you know, the Lord of the Rings. I don't want to go through them again, but movies that have the mythical or folklore or magical elements, that defines a fantasy movie to me. And I agree with Neil. I think there is negative connotation associated with it. I think it's bullshit and it shouldn't happen because it's fun. I may not like D&D as much as you guys, but I love playing with you guys. And I do like some of the stories, like Gary, the campaign you're running right now. I'm not brown nosing. It's probably my favorite one next year.
I didn't mention mine at all, but okay, sure.
He's not brown nosing your campaigns, Tom.
I know they do.
You like to just beat us up. You're like an abusive husband.
Well, edit all of this out.
So yeah, that's the answer. That's the end of the question. Earlier, I had posed the question: why does fantasy have a bad rep?
Yeah, I don't know if we can say why it has. I think we just acknowledge that it does have a bad rep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe is it because are the budgets too big? You know, if you look at all of those, every single what we might consider stereotypical a fantasy film, God, look at the budgets for all those things. I mean, they're hundreds of millions of dollars as opposed to a horror movie where, fuck man, they made The Babadook and they made It Lives. Yeah,
I think it might be because of that feeling that it's sort of a children's thing, you know, because you look at like. Because Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King was the first fantasy movie to win Best Picture. And, you know, that's, I think, showing the level of acceptance. I mean, they made a lot of money as well, but, you know, sort of showing the level of acceptance like, oh, a fantasy can be a well-crafted movie as well, you know, and even though it shows like for children, you know, that's sort of the stigma that is coming out of.
Out of what?
It's coming out of the stigma that it's for children.
Oh, I don't know that I'm not saying it didn't win, but Lord of the Rings is such a monolithic juggernaut of literature, not just fantasy. A well-made movie of Lord of the Rings. I think it's straddling its genre. I don't think it's fair to say it was the first fantasy. I think the fact that it was fantasy is just happenstance. I think anything that major.
I'm saying it's the first fantasy that won Best Picture.
And I'm saying I don't think that shows acceptance of society for fantasy. I'm saying that's a story that is huge. You didn't have to be a fantasy nerd. Like a D&D, more people than just D&D players read Lord of the Rings. So I think that it was going to win that. I don't know if you can use that as a litmus for acceptance.
I don't think a lot of people read Lord of the Rings.
What the hell would you know? You've never cracked a book in your life.
Oh, here we go. Here we fuck go again.
Mother loves me more.
All right, so.
Edit this again. Take this out.
I think we're. Let's wrap this up. Yes. So let me ask everybody. We'll start with our guests today. We'll start with Chuck because
we all know
I like Chuck better. give us a fantasy movie recommendation for our many listeners.
Okay. Okay, so I loved this movie when I was a kid, and I will still watch it from time to time. But there's a movie that came out, I think it was in the 90s, called Dragonheart.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And Sean Connery does the voice for the dragon. And it's seriously one of the most quotable movies I've ever watched.
Mm-hmm. I quoted it just yesterday, actually.
Yeah, see? Exactly. So it's really good. I really enjoy it. Really good acting. Yeah, at the time it was pretty mind blowing.
Nope. Okay, Dragonheart is Chuck's recommendation.
Yeah, you haven't seen Dragonheart? There's only one of them. There is a sequel, but I have never watched it.
I think there are four sequels.
Yeah. Holy crap, that's unbelievable.
I believe so, yes. Okay, Tom, what would your fantasy movie recommendation be?
I think that if I was going to recommend a movie, as sort of a gateway drug into the fantasy genre, mm-hmm. I would suggest Willow from 1988.
Willow!
Yes.
It's pretty much got everything.
So
it's, it's what you think of when you think of fantasy, mm-hmm. as Jonny was saying. He's like, you know, you've got to have the fantastic elements, really. Although, of course, the best fantasy movie ever would be Spider-Man 2.
Yes, of course. That's just hands down the best movie ever. Yeah. I'm glad that...
Across all genres.
Yeah, okay, good. Jonny, what would your fantasy movie recommendation be?
Well, I would normally go with one of the Lord of the Rings ones. But we've been talking about it a lot. I would recommend a movie that came out... the movie is Guillermo del Toro's Pan's Labyrinth.
Oh, yeah, I think that was 2006.
Six, yes, thank you. I was thinking 2007. Tom, you cheated. You looked at Google.
No, I swear.
I'm in another house. I have no way to go with that. Pan's Labyrinth, it it definitely, as we talked about, a lot of films straddling the line of genres they're in, it definitely jumps into kind of the horror aspect. And I think that's mainly because of Guillermo del Toro's vision and his directing in general. Most of his films are normally like that. But it's a fantastic watch if you don't mind subtitles, you like a foreign film. It found pretty decent commercial success over here in the States. So, pants leather.
Okay. Before we move on past that, did you see Hellboy 2? Because that was directed by Guillermo del Toro.
I love The Golden Army. I really did. I think it got a lot of flack, but I really
did. Do you count it as fantasy?
Yes, I would count that as fantasy because of the elves, because of the elven kingdom.
That's the only reason? And you know,
That's not the only reason. I mean, Hellboy 1 was fantasy. You know,
because
you,
of the demon.
You have to come back.
Well,
that's one of the reasons. Yeah. But that's the thing we were talking about with the superheroes earlier, was that the protagonist was receiving their powers from a magical or mythical presence or being or source of power or whatever. It wasn't. And I was saying that, you know, action adventure, primarily those superheroes that rely on action adventure are the ones that get it from natural skills or the money that they have, science, things like that. And in Hellboy, they receive all of their powers from
supernatural different realms. Yeah. I know we were wrapping up, but Jonny said something I got to ask a question about.
Sure.
Okay. So this kind of addresses all the stuff we're talking about where you're like, oh, it's, you know, the difference between fantasy and science fiction and superheroes and where they get their powers. Where do you rate Captain America on this scale? Because there's no
10 out of 10.
I mean, where is it fantasy? Is it action? Because he's definitely a man of action, but he's at least a low level superhero because he's able to do things that are just beyond the realm of, you know, a normal human being.
Right. But he is, I would still have to say because he was scientifically enhanced. His powers, they were natural skills. He didn't receive any of the, they're not, I mean, he's a super soldier, but you know, he's not Superman. He's not Thor. He's not Captain Marvel. Excuse me. Captain Marvel.
Suzanne.
Dr. Strange. I thought.
No, that's a whole discussion for its own program.
Never mind. Oh man, I was really hoping we would make it through the whole thing without saying Captain Marvel.
I'll let that out. Don't worry.
Yeah, just cut that part out.
Neil, since I've guessed your recommendation several times, I'm going to let you go first so I don't accidentally steal yours this week.
I appreciate it. Because it has been at least like three or four picks in a row that you've stolen from me. My recommendation this week, for those who haven't seen it, it's a small little independent film from 2008 called The Gamers Darkness Rising.
There you go.
The Gamers 2, by the way. It is the second.
The first one is unwatchable, and I think they came out with a third one, which is
even worse.
You know, it's ironic because the third one is about a card game, collectible card game.
But anyway, if you're wanting to watch a film based on the game Dungeons and Dragons, The Gamers Darkness Rising is a good segue into it. They do a pretty good job of covering it.
And it's very realistic.
It's quite horrible too.
Yeah.
Is it so bad it's good?
No, it's so good.
It's so great it's right.
Okay. Just want to make sure.
Okay. I'm going to recommend a movie from the 1970s called Wizards, which is an animated film.
Yes.
Chuck, you've seen it?
Yes.
I love it. It's from the 70s, so if you've ever seen heavy metal, you'll kind of understand the artwork style.
Oh, yeah.
It's just very bizarre, and it's about a wizard who's trying to kill
his brother.
Wizard Hitler, basically.
Cut that part out here.
Does he do a voice in that?
I think that's before he started.
Because it was like maybe mid-set. I don't know.
He does a voice in Batman the Animated Series, which is fantasy.
Well, obviously, he is famous for that voice.
But yeah, so,
I think he's famous for his role in Guyver, really.
Okay. Okay, Tom. Okay, Tom. But yeah, Wizards will be my recommendation. It's I think it's 79, I want to say, somewhere around there.
Oh, is it that late?
And maybe earlier. But it's definitely one hell of a trip if you want to take a fantasy trip. And it's kind of steampunky, too.
Yeah, that's all. Seems accurate to me. Speaking of late 70s movies, do you consider Jaws fantasy?
Well, everyone, that's our show today. Thank you for joining us on this week's episode of I Don't Give a Flick. I'm your host, Gary Elmore, and with me as always is...
Oh, so you are the host. I'm just trying to understand how this whole thing operates. So just let me know when we start, and I'll straighten up and I'll stop being so funny.
This will be Tom's one and only podcast.
It was great. Thanks for having me.
Chuck, thanks for stopping by.
And Chuck, thanks so much for stopping by, guys. It was a pleasure having you this week.
Yeah, that was fun.
Perfect. We'll have to do
it
again.
It was good hanging out with you, Chuck, and Gary, and Neil.
Same here.
Alrighty.
Definitely had a good time.
Until next time, everyone, stay classy.
Thank you for tuning in to Lead Feather Productions' podcast of I Don't Give a Flick. Make sure to subscribe to our podcast so that you never miss an episode. Podcasts are available on Apple, Spotify, Google Podcasts, YouTube, and everywhere podcasts are hosted. I Don't Give a Flick is hosted and produced by Jonny Blackburn, Gary Elmore, and Neil Riley. Executive producer Jonny Blackburn, technical director, editor, and audio mixer Gary Elmore. I Don't Give a Flick is a Lead Feather production, copyright Lead Feather Productions 2020.